Hello, Potters, and welcome to episode 108 of Cospod, the podcast for all things cosplay. We are getting up there in episodes, man. This is awesome. Of course, Bella's a little bit less than energetic because she caught the near equivalent of the PAX Pox, a.k.a. Con Plague.
Close, but not quite.
Yeah, that's why I said almost. The almost PAX Pox.
The infamous PAX Pox, which, oddly enough, was featured in Drawful, Penny Arcade, and Friends on Sunday, of all things.
Yes, so when they say a pox on both your houses, this fairly literally happens at PAX.
Yeah, it's a requirement. Yeah. But as I was telling Amber earlier, that means I now have sexy Phoebe voice, so I'm okay with this. I may be a little sick, but I sound great.
So if anybody needs someone to record the messages for your customer service help desk, please call Val.
I'll be happy to do it. $50 an hour.
Dang, woman.
I don't come cheap.
I hope it doesn't take you an hour to record it.
Well, if you want it to sound perfectly, yeah, definitely it's going to take me an hour. Oh, goodness.
Anyway, so basically, my cosplay updates are kind of awkward because most of my stuff is actually drying on my coffee table. Thankfully, in Texas, we had an absolutely gorgeous weekend. It was about 75 degrees, a little bit on the breezy side, but there was very little humidity. It was great. And since my apartment faces the same direction the wind is blowing, I have no windows on the south side, and the wind was out of the south. So I was sitting here going, I'm facing the north. Heck yes. No wind for me. So I spent all of my weekend, I have to hold it together because I haven't actually glued these parts down yet, but you know, I have the beginnings of Irelia's side blades. That's eventually going to get glued down. So yeah, you can see this is one quarter of it. It's actually 5 feet tall because yeah, there's four parts to it. But I do need to install the magnets, finish kind of touching up all the gold parts, cover up the carbon fiber backing that is Evafoam with standard foam. And then, you know, drill holes for magnets and assemble the whole thing. I'm already working on the blade that sits at her back. That one's actually going to be a little easier because I don't have to bevel any of it. But I do have to build a harness for myself to wear that will go underneath the dress. And oh God, life keeps getting in the way, man. I keep trying to be productive. I am trying so hard to be productive on this cosplay and have it done for AllCon because I really want to wear it to AllCon. I want to have a new cosplay. But every time I go to get things done, it's just like, oh, you have to go do a repair at your house. Or, oh, the family wants to do lunch. Or, oh, hey, you have a concert coming up. And all of the music is not easy and you have to practice every night. Oh, and I'm on call. At least I was on call last week and I'm the backup on call this week. So if something blows up, then I have to drop what I'm doing and go fix it. So yeah, the life of an adult cosplayer. But at least I'm getting something done, even if it's not done for AllCon. Then at least I'm making progress, and I'll just wear it to AllCon or something.
Something is better than nothing. We all have adulting issues.
Yeah, I'm getting there as best as I can, and I really am trying. In between games of League of Legends.
That's where it comes in League. Ha!
No, life seriously is getting in the way.
And League.
I play League when I can't work on cosplay. I don't think my downstairs neighbors would appreciate me running a scroll saw at 10 p.m. at night.
Eh.
I am the Minotaur upstairs because I am the upstairs neighbor. I have to try not to be the Minotaur.
As you clomp around your apartment, sawing things.
Sawing things, running a heat gun, spray painting things. I'm sure my neighbors are all eventually going to learn what it is I'm doing and give me those funny looks that everybody gets.
Yeah.
Whenever you have neighbors who don't know what cosplay is and they're like, what are you doing? Okay, I'm just going to back away slowly now.
Exactly. Okay. Bye, weird neighbor.
I am the weird neighbor.
Yeah, we're accustomed to it now. We're just like, whatever. That's what we do. Deal.
Yep. So that has pretty much been my cosplay update.
I guess it's my turn then, huh? She's nodding at me. Okay, so first off, I'm going to show off the wig that I finished last weekend during the previous cosplay updates. The massive head trauma of doom. And look at all this coolness and braiding. Ah, yay. So the wig base is actually from Arda, and it's a lace front wig, which you can kind of barely see because I trimmed it back so far. And it's got two packages of wefts in the sucker, and it does have a foam core in here. The foam core is part foam core, as I bang everything on my table. And then I also used Easy Felt, which we learned from Quantum Destiny. And I was like, that's a brilliant idea because it actually ended up halving the weight of my wig. And so the actual weight of this is only about 3 pounds. And I got a chance to wear this at PAX South. I had no trouble with it. I even brought aspirin with me, thinking I'm going to have a headache by the middle of the day. Nope, no problems. Had no headache. I was good. So, yeah, I'm going to try to put a tutorial up on how I made this beast of a thing. I've got a lot of pictures on my personal cosplay page, so you guys can always look at that. But yeah, this is probably one of the more challenging wigs I've ever worked on, and I'm incredibly impressed at myself that I got this done. Speaking of which, Amber, I have a ton of Easy Felt left over because I overbought. So I'm going to be gifting it to you. So when we work on stubbing your wig, we can use that instead of a foam core, and it'll work equally as well. So there you go. I have felt just for you. Enjoy. And that's pretty much it as far as like my cosplay updates, because as most of you already know, I went to PAX South this past weekend. So that's going to be the bulk of my updates. I guess should we just go ahead and get into the review? She's nodding at me. She doesn't want to talk. She wants me to lose my voice again. Amber, talk.
Arf. Mission accomplished.
Okay. Okay. I
Mean,
think I
what do you
deserve.
want me to say? I mean, I unfortunately I could not go to PAX South because I was on call for work,
Right?
and having done that last year and actually been summoned back to the office from the middle of the convention at ACON, I didn't want to risk that again because it's not like I can just drive back to the office from San Antonio. So unfortunately, I had to sell my ticket and stay home. And I actually watched live on the stream on Twitch. So they streamed a decent portion of the panels, mostly from the main theater,
Right.
and there were a couple from the arena as well. And so basically, I just tried to live vicariously through the PAX stream, which unfortunately is full of, the Twitch generation, so chat was left a lot to be desired, so I
Yep.
kind of ignored most of the chat. But it was all I could do to kind of console myself from not being able to go.
Hopefully we can make up for that next year. I think you would have had a lot of fun at this one because they had a ton of tabletop gaming this time around, and way more than what was normal. Because I'm used to seeing a lot of tabletop at PAX, but this was like a ridiculous amount. It wasn't just the expo hall, but they actually expanded the section of the expo hall lineup where they gave tabletop an additional area to play around in. And I was like, dude, that's a lot of tabletop.
There's a lot of gaming groups in Texas, and there's a lot of gaming companies in Texas. And I knew that
Yep.
South was going to be the big tabletop and tournament, console tournament con. And that's why I wanted to go this year. I wanted so much to go and just relax with other gamers because I very rarely get to go and just veg with other gamers. And I wanted to so much, just again, adult life got in
Adulting.
the way. Yeah, and unfortunately, with this, because I have a symphony concert basically right on top of PAX South, so unless that changes, I'm basically gonna end up having to choose between the two. And unfortunately, symphony pays me, and PAX does not. So there is that.
We're not big or fancy enough to get media badges because one of the requirements is 50,000 Facebook likes. So, that's just not going to happen in
Hey,
our
if you
state.
guys want us to be press next year at PAX South, you know what to do now.
Spam
Start racking up the
Facebook.
likes, sharing our page.
Like, and all the likes. And then even more likes on top of that.
So our screen is just going to go boop, 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 all with the icon of the like.
I can make that happen. I'm the editor.
Thought you might.
Well,
Okay,
hopefully.
I've delayed enough.
Yeah, you're cool. This is part of the thing. This is our banter. This is what we do. This is the thing that we does. Hopefully you can make it for next year, because I think it's something that you would really have enjoyed, and I'll keep my fingers crossed for you on that.
It will all depend on life and how much time off I have and not being on call.
Yeah.
And whether or not Symphony still does a strings concert in February. The first weekend in February.
February, yeah. Well, they can suck it and hold off a couple of weeks.
I like Symphony. Symphony's a big deal.
I know it is. It's a very important part of your life.
Yes.
But so is gaming, because gaming's fun.
Yes. It's also a very important part of my life.
Yeah. Hey, nerdy. Okay, so on to my wonderful and not so grotesque review. I don't know. And that was not the verbiage or adjective I was looking for, so I apologize. I can't think straight. My brain is all fuzzy because I'm sick. And it's like, I just got my voice back today, so I'm still kind of like catching up and getting my brain to work properly. I like last year, kind of how I'm going to do this review is going to be more like a general list of things that I like and dislike about the event, because like it's not really easy for me to do a day by day play by play, because it's a lot of like going to the expo floor and then running up to a panel and then going back to the expo floor and then going to hang out with friends. So trying to do a day by day just doesn't really make sense in my brain in this type of situation. It's easier just to talk about all the things that I liked about PAX and all the things I didn't like about it. First and foremost, it's important to note that expos like this typically aren't very cosplay heavy. The emphasis is really on the new games that are coming out and talking to the developers about what's going to be released, things like that. It's not to say there isn't cosplay, because obviously there is cosplay there. Cosplay does show up pretty much at any convention these days, but it's not the main focus like it is at anime conventions. And there was quite an increase in cosplay compared to previous years. Like, I definitely saw a lot more people cosplaying. There were a lot more meetups, a lot more group hangouts, especially with the League of Legends and the Borderlands group, nearly doubled in size compared to last year. And they had a pretty big following last year, too. I think also it's because we are in the South and we are in Texas, and Texas is a very big cosplay state, despite what people may believe. So it's no surprise to me that, you know, first 2 years of PAX, we see quite a large amount of cosplayers attending compared to even like PAX Prime or PAX East. So here are the things that I enjoyed and did not enjoy so much about PAX South this year. This is year two of the greatness that is. First things first, that cell reception still blows monkey chunks. And I see Amber giggling. I'm at this point where I believe that it's the entire city of San Antonio that has really crappy cell reception, and it's not just the convention center. Like, I'm 150% convinced of this now, because there were times where we were going into the mall and my cell reception would completely blank out and was emergency calls only. And it's like, seriously, I am in the mall. I am hundreds and hundreds of feet and yardages away from the convention center, and I still can't get any reception.
And yardages? How imperial of you.
I know, right? I was being on top of it now.
Anyways.
But seriously, it's just one of those things where I sit there and like, okay, this is a city of 1.4 million people. Yes, I Googled this and I double-checked. That's a 2013 stat. In Dallas, we have like 1.25 mil. I double-checked that too, so it is right. You would think that a city of that size would have the capabilities to maintain proper cell reception, especially since there's an AT&T tower no more than a couple of blocks away. But it was just abysmal. It was terrible. You couldn't make connections with anybody or any people. It was just a nightmare. And it's no wonder that the people inside the expo hall who were selling things were able to get a great reception, because you paid $79.99 a day for Wi-Fi there. I know, you have to pay for the Wi-Fi at the convention center. It's ridiculous. But hey, because they were the only ones on the network, they got really fast credit card transactions. Good for them.
I was going to say, you know what you need to do is you need to have the companies that do the calling over Wi-Fi, and then just hop on the Wi-Fi network and make your phone call.
Yep. Yep.
Or you can pay the $79.95 or whatever to get on the wireless, and then you just rent out your little bit of bandwidth. everybody wants to make a phone call.
It's so ridiculous, though, because that shouldn't be an issue. And I think I'm more annoyed at the fact that there's a new section of the convention center that just got unveiled earlier last week. And even that has zero Wi-Fi capabilities. And I'm like, dudes, it's 2016. You need to fix this. This is an issue. Especially if PAX continues to be there for the next couple of years, which has already been confirmed. You need to fix this issue because it's a gaming expo. We're all going to be on our cell phones. We're all going to be tweeting and Facebooking and Instagramming like mad. Which kind of made for another problem because a lot of the giveaways, which is what PAX is known for, is you get a lot of giveaways and grab bags and stuff. A lot of booths wanted you to get on their Twitter and follow them or to, you know, snap a photo and send it to their Instagram account. Well, I can't really do that because the Wi-Fi is dead. So explain to me how I can get this free item without using my phone. So I know we missed out on a lot of really cool buttons and like plushies and stuff like that because of that lovely, fun issue. But I am grateful to the developers who learned that lesson last year and didn't try to pull that crap. And were just kind enough to say, here's your free t-shirt. Thank you. I appreciate that immensely.
It's better marketing that way.
Exactly. I get my free item without having to sign up for extra junk. Hey. Cool beans. So this year they also made a lot of changes to the layout of the convention center. They ended up moving the entrance to the other side of the building. So instead of being right next to the Hyatt, you had to walk around and through and go through security, which is fine. But I know it made a couple of guests not too happy that they had to do additional walking. And I could see why they did this. The main events theater is right next to the Hyatt. And it caused a ton of traffic issues last year. And basically, this was to help mitigate it. They also created a line system specifically for the expo hall that was a lot easier to circle through. And it allowed you to pass through all the tabletop gaming in one fell swoop. So I actually really like the layout. I think it really benefited the expo because of it. The only downside was that they didn't have as many big name panels going on this year. So it was kind of simmered down on the type of content that was available. And actually, for me, that was kind of a big issue because I really didn't get a chance to highlight or go to a lot of the panels that I thought would be like fantastic or awesome. Like the ones that I had highlighted were the video game theory panel, and then one was how to turn your craft into a business panel. Sounds like something that I would be interested in and something that Cosplay would be interested in. Cool, two birds with one stone. From what I heard from the video game theory panel, it really ended up just turning into a chat session about what we like about video games. It's not game theory, guys. I'm sorry. That's not what I signed up for. I'm kind of glad that I didn't go to that now. I was in line to play a Resident Evil game. And then the other one is crafting, turning your craft into a business. My concern with that one is that the people that were on the panel, I had no idea who they were. I had never heard their businesses before. Now, if they were something like from Glitch Apparel or from Sanshi, one of the really big name companies like that who really do like a bunch of geeky products and have really turned into a multi-mega business, yeah, I think that would have been much more interesting to go into. But these mom and pop shops that are on Etsy and they do, you know, enough as a side business, but not as enough for supplemental income, I do that already. That was nothing new to me. So I was a little bummed out by the lack of panel content because of that. But instead, you got tournaments galore because, oh my goodness, there were tournaments out the wazoo. I think my favorite one was the fact there was a goat simulator tournament. And I still can't even explain how the tournament worked or what the rules were. I just knew I stood there and I watched it and I was mesmerized by it. And it was basically people were given a 5-minute time limit to get as many points as possible. And you saw some crazy things going on with those goats that I was not aware you could do in Goat Simulator. So I'm going to try those out eventually.
Okay, that just sounds kinky.
Goat Simulator is an odd, odd game. It could be kinky to some people.
Well, when you say there are things going on that I didn't think could go on in Goat Simulator, there were crazy things. It's like, wait, what? Was this like an adult-rated Goat Simulator?
No, it's a G-rated game. You do have the ability to lick that's things. Okay, you can lick things.
That's a very goat thing to do.
It is a goat thing to do. However, the The fact that your tongue is kind of a bug in the game and it can stick to things and it won't let go. So you'll get stuck to people and to cars and the trains and the planes and the houses and buzzsaws and, yeah, fireworks and explosions. You know, you're a goat. You lick things and you blow stuff up. This is the game that has the Michael Bay explosion achievement, by the way. Just want to point that out. So, yeah, there were a ton of tournaments over the weekend. The Omegathon, I think, is probably one of the best game lineups I had seen in a long, long time between Beautiful Katamari and Ice Climbers, and then the final round was GoldenEye 64. Oh, my goodness. It was hysterical. Thank you, Amber, for pointing that out to me, because I was sitting in the airport going like, ah, I wish I was there watching it now. That was awesomely funny. I think Mario Maker was much more entertaining, but this was just as good. Just as good. Because, man, nothing is better than seeing a bunch of young kids who have zero clue how to play the old bogey games. It was epically awesome.
I felt so bad for Rug Pisser.
I know!
He was the runner-up last year as well. Mm-hmm. And, of course, for those who don't know about the Omegathon, basically, they take a random group of people who are chosen out of the attendees. Basically, you sign up and say, yes, I want to be an Omeganaut. And they take that pool of people and they randomly choose a number of them. And you go head-to-head in random video games, whatever they choose, whatever they feel like is your Omegathon this year. So when you get to the final round, the winner gets to attend a PAX of their choice. Any PAX around the world, they will fly you there. That is the grand prize. The runner-up gets to return as an Omeganaut, guaranteed, the next year. It's kind of a consolation prize.
Mm.
So last year, Rug Pisser was the runner-up, so he was guaranteed a spot in the Omegathon this year. So he made it all the way to the finals again this year, and again he was the runner-up, so he will be back at the Omegathon guaranteed next year. I felt so bad. And he was one shot away from winning. One.
Yeah. It was a good match.
9-9, and it was to 10 kills.
It was a good match. But yeah, you just kind of felt like your heart go, oh, poor guy. But, you know, a guaranteed free round run next year, plus you got your tickets paid for. I mean, that's not so bad. I'm okay with that as a consolation.
It's not bad. I just felt bad that he doesn't, you know, after all that work, he still has to go back and do it again.
Oh, man. But I think that's part of the fun of PAX is you go out and you get to see these tournaments in person. And there's just something about being in that atmosphere. And it's so much fun and it's lively. And it's different from watching it on Twitch, which, by the way, Twitch was there broadcasting a bunch of stuff as well. Because we sat in on a couple of other fights going on, such as Super Smash Brothers. We had Hearthstone going on at the same time, which we both tried to enter and get into. We barely just missed the cutoff on both days, so we couldn't get into it. Gave us more time to play other games, though, so I'm okay with that. And I do have to say that this year's expo ran just as smoothly, if not better, than last year's. I know some people will probably complain that there weren't as many big-name developers there. Woohoo! PAX, to me, has always been about the indie crowd and has really promoted itself as being the type of group that wants to elevate video games. So it's not just catering to, you know, EA and Ubisoft and all those guys. It's about all the other developers out there who want to make a name for themselves and are trying to get their content out there.
Yeah, plus if you look at it, we just had CES.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of the big name devs just came back from CES, from presenting. So I can understand if they didn't have it in the budget to attend something like PAX South, which, like you said, really is meant for the more indie crowd. It's
exactly.
Really meant for the more small business developers.
Exactly. And I thought it was really cool because I didn't realize this, but some of our pals from Mythos Creations were there because they know somebody who got featured as one of PAX's indie developers to watch. So he had his game on the floor and we got to watch it. And I was like, that's pretty darn cool. Just the fact that we have like 6 degrees of separation. The circle is so tiny now. So yeah, to me, that's always been the fun part, is to go out there and play these games, and you get to actually talk to developers and learn about their process and what they like to see about the game. My favorite thing to do is to play the games and try to break them, which you'd think would annoy most people, but actually developers want that to happen, because this is basically
their free QA.
Yeah, it's their testing ground. They want to see what you do to the game so they can go back and fix it. And I was breaking a couple of games.
Plus, one of the other nice things about PAX is that the chairman emeritus, you know, Gabe and Taco, they're out there playing the games with you.
Oh, yeah.
You can literally chat with them as you are playing them at a game, which I find really cool.
Yeah, a lot of the YouTube stars that they invited this year were out on the floor with us and doing the exact same thing. I actually ran into Holly Conrad, who, if you guys know the name, probably sounds very familiar. She's one half of Crabcat, who was also on Heroes of Cosplay. She happened to be there, and she knows a couple of friends of ours, and I just met her, and I was like, hi, I'm going to take a very awkward selfie with you because you're cool and I like you. But she was there gaming with the rest of us, and I was like, that's cool too because she's a YouTube star. So that to me is also one of the nice things about it, and that's people were able to meet Mark Plyer last year doing the exact same thing. He was out on the floor playing games, and they were able to saddle right up next to him. I apparently talked to somebody from Twitch who's got like 100,000 followers. I had no idea. We were playing a game called Brawlhalla, which is the PC version of Smash Brothers, basically. And apparently this guy was playing next to me and we were kicking each other's butts. I had no idea who the heck he was, but apparently people were so engrossed by the fact that the two of us were playing together, they were taking a ton of pictures of him. And now I'm internet famous because of that. I have no idea why, but I was like, okay, whatever. I'm cool with that.
When it comes to gaming, when you put the controller in your hand, the number of followers no longer matters. You are equal in a battle of games.
Exactly. He rightly kicked my butt because it was my first time playing, but it was still fun. So, all that gaming mess aside, we got to talk about the cosplay because that's the cosplay podcast. We talk about cosplay, duh. So, as I mentioned before, cosplay is not the big draw of this convention, but there was definitely a lot of it this year. And there was a ton of meetups, like way more than I ever anticipated. Even on Saturday, we had a very impromptu mini Final Fantasy meetup out of nowhere because we just had like 8 of us standing in a circle going like, can we just make this a meetup and have this happen? Okay, cool. And it just kind of happened that way. And it was just really cool to see. And PAX doesn't typically have a large number of cosplays, even at Prime, but it's always fun to see people come in and show off their costumes. And it's cool to see the variety of costumes, too. You saw a couple of the anime characters, and that's fine. But there were, like, a lot of mascot costumes, too. Like, there were Sesame Street characters and Gumby and Plants vs. Zombies, which that was really cool. I was very impressed by that. But then you had, like, you know, Street Fighter and Mario. We had a huge Bloodborne group and the Pooh Monster of Doom. I'll show. This is where I'll put pictures in here. There will be a slideshow. I promise it'll make sense. I swear. So it's also really great that the location is very photogenic. Unlike some of the other PAX locations, this one is one of those where you can just walk like a couple of blocks and, oh, you got a pretty spot for a lake and flowers and waterfalls, or you can go over here and you get a nice cool grungy area. So it helps that the area is really cool for photos. So which
for
I'm
those
sure
who don't know, this is held at the Henry B. Gonzalez Convention Center, which is the same one San Japan is held at. So if that name sounds familiar, it's because that's where San Japan is held.
It's good for lots of pretty photos. It emphasizes the pretty photos. And we also had like our own little like Southern cosplayer gathering of just a bunch of people come together, take photos, be silly for an hour before we all dispersed and went our own separate ways. So that in itself was just really, really cool. And I'm hoping that because there's been such an increase vastly in cosplay at PAX South, that more of the developers will kind of look at it and be like, okay, maybe we should start doing some things for the cosplayers. Maybe we can hold our own mini cosplay contests or give away extra prizes and stuff like that. So that'll be nice to see if they can actually start building up on that.
Are you offering CosFun to run this cosplay?
God, no. No, we have too much to do. I don't think we could do 2 back-to-back. I would be very exhausted. Very, very exhausted. So no. No.
I thought you would say as much.
So overall, I had a ton of fun. I'm a little sad that I get to spend more time with my friends, but you know, we did experience a ton of new games. I even experienced a lot of tabletop games, and I am not a tabletop person, but I was really into the tabletop this time, especially the Exploding Kittens game.
Did you level up?
I did level up. I leveled up twice. I'm super cool now. Yeah, the Exploding Kittens card game is one of the most, okay, hang on. It was the most funded Kickstarter tabletop game to date. That may have altered slightly in the past week or so, because I know there's another one that's pretty close to it. Just can't remember the name of it off the top of my head. But yeah, that was an entertaining tabletop game. but I do want to add in really quickly two of my favorite game picks from the expo. Since, of course, this is a gaming event. Duh, you talk about things and you play video games. I do want to point out that I'm going to have a bunch of features on my personal blog called The Geek Spot, which is going to go over a lot of the indie games that I had a chance to play with, get up close with, and all that fun kind of stuff. So if you're interested in more gaming news, go there. But I do want to mention two of my favorites that I think are appropriate for this podcast that I could possibly see people actually cosplaying from, especially this first game. My favorite mobile one is called Like a Boss. Let that seep for a moment. So the concept is you are the ultra mega super boss in an MMO. A raid has been sent in to kill you, and your goal is to destroy everyone in the raid before they kill you. It is probably the most mindless, simple game I have played in a long time. It'll be perfect for my lunch breaks, but it is a ridiculous amount of fun. And I think the one reason I like it is because there's a lot of colorful commentary coming from the raid. Like, people are saying, you know, I hope these boots drop, or, oh my God, noob, what are you doing? Like, you just have this random banter going on between the NPCs that you're killing, and it's just hysterical. It's supposed to be out for a tablet and potentially Android later this spring, so I'm definitely looking forward to it. My console pick is called Inner Space. I am completely obsessed with this video game. Like, they put the controller in my hand, and I did not want to put it down. I was probably in that booth for about an hour. I was completely absorbed by this game. It is beautiful beyond belief, really easy to play, fun to play. It's going to be available for PC, Mac, Linux, and potentially the PS4, which is why I said it's console. But the concept is you're a ship, and you have to fly into the core of planets to find pieces of a puzzle. And as you pick up more pieces, you learn more about the backstory of why you're flying into planets and all that stuff. It's kind of got this Journey vibe mixed in with Super Mario Galaxy control scheme, because you're in a planet, so it's got this curvature going on as you're flying around. It takes a little bit of time getting used to the controls. I found it kind of easy because I played a lot of Galaxy, and that requires a lot of gravity and curving and jumping. But it's one of those games that is just so mesmerizing and so beautiful to look at that all you want to do is just fly around. Like, you don't want to play the game to pick up puzzle pieces. You just want to fly around and dive into oceans and go through trees and all these cool things that they have going on. So, yeah, you probably spend more time just looking at all the prettiness instead of actually playing the game as it was intended. I also spent a lot of time breaking it. A lot. Which the developers were very grateful for. They were like, I think we're going to hire you as our new QA because you're finding new bugs we hadn't found yet. So I was like, yes. So yeah, that's my summary of PAX. I'm really hoping for a lot of greatness coming out of it next year. I don't think the attendance will be as high because people weren't seeing a whole lot of big developers there. But I think as PAX continues to grow year over year, we'll get more of the big names down. And we're definitely going to see a ton of more cosplayers. I'm almost positive of it. I think cosplay is going to end up slowly taking over PAX South. And then they're going to be like, okay, we kind of need to do something for them. Because they're clearly bringing their A game. We got to do something for them. There you go. Cheers. I'm going to go sit over here with my tea while my voice recuperates.
Well, unfortunately, I can't follow that myself, but I can give you guys an awesome interview. I was able to sit down with the lovely Fev, and just, I wanted to say this briefly before we air this, is that I've known Fev since the cosplay.com days. And if you're old enough to remember the heyday of cosplay.com, then you're kind of about our generation. that's saying something. So I've been following her work for a long time is kind of the point of this. And I have been a fan of her work for a long time. So it was kind of a bit of a dream for me to be able to sit down and interview her. And I'm not saying this to be nice. Like, I have wanted to interview her for a long time. and we were finally able to do it. And I was like, oh, this is so cool. I get to sit down with famous people.
Now you know how I felt when we interviewed Quantum Destiny. I was trying to hold that in because I was like, this is face-to-face. Oh, crap, I got to be cool.
Because you guys know that I'm primarily a prop maker. And so for me to sit down with talented prop makers is really cool because I enjoy talking shop and I enjoy learning things. And I did learn something in this interview, and you guys will see it when she gives you guys, you know, the tips and tricks for beginners. You guys, I think, will learn something new as well. And if you have a chance, go take a look at her website, because some of her more recent works, I didn't even know she had done Legolas Quipper from Lord of the Rings. The thing is a piece of art. It's not just a prop, it's art. It's so well made. Oh. And she does write-ups on each of them as well. Check out her shop. She does sell blueprints. She sells resin castings of a few of her props. I think she may or may not sell finished copies of a few of those. And usually she is okay with, you know, being asked questions like, how did you do this? And we sat down. We had a great interview because a lot of people feel kind of anxious whenever we interview them. But I think it went really well. I really do. So I'm hoping you guys enjoy this as much as I did. So without further ado, my interview with Fev. Hey Potters, Amber here, and I have the lovely Lee of Fev Studios here with me today. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Hey, thank you for inviting me. Thanks.
And of course, we know Fev for all of her work on Skyrim as well as Assassin's Creed. So we wanted to give you guys an opportunity to see her art and to have a chance to talk to her about it.
Oh.
So, Lee, you've been around for quite a while in the cosplay scene. So yeah. You were probably there when cosplay was first, you know, getting started on its, you know, little baby legs. So yeah, what was your conventioning like in the early years of cosplay?
Well, my very first cosplay and convention, I was a huge fan of a fighting game called Samurai Showdown. And nice. Haomaru, you know, like the dude with the hair that went. And I was bored in February and modded some PJs and just to goof off, and had a friend come over to my house. And he was like laughing his butt off. We took stupid pictures. And then I was like autographing them and bringing them to like the local arcade where I was a regular and handing them to friends like Dan Hibiki. And like, I started hearing about this convention stuff. So in 98 was like my very first con. We did a friend of mine and I did a road trip out to Dallas for Project Acon 3. And I was so nervous. I was like in the bathroom, like, oh God, where am I? And I said, you know what? I'm just going to kind of like throw on this silly PJs and stick in some weave hair in the back so it all sticks out and just go into character. And that was pretty much it. I started just doing the cost, just goofing off and everything. And then, you know, it was just, I started doing a few props here and there. I did some martial arts school, broadswords, and other stuff like that. So I really did a lot of like woodworking before then. So I made props and made an excuse and then, you know, had the costumes as excuses to run around with the props. So, you know, that wound up being like kind of my thing, but I did a lot of illustration. So I just, most of the conventioning between 98 and 2006 was selling prints of art at conventions and then seeing people in costumes and going, you know, that was kind of fun. I want to do that again. Yeah, cool.
PJs so is then, a great way to start.
Yeah, just PJs and fabric paint.
It was comfy scissors.
Yes, it was. Oh my gosh. Okay, yeah, that's probably the only 100% comfortable costume I've ever had. So,
of course, now they're a little less comfortable to wear. Yeah.
It's like I can't sit. I can't touch my toes. It feels like each time it gets worse. You know, this costume's like, oh, this is hot. Oh, I'm going to die at Dragon Con. And then the next year I make the next one. I'm going to die at Dragon Con. That last one wasn't even bad. What was I talking about?
So it's like almost as we've progressed in the years of cosplay, in the timeline, we're getting less and less comfortable.
Yeah.
And less simple as time goes on.
Oh, it's absolutely. I mean, it feels like we're trying to like swell out and we're like, oh, we could top our own this thing. We have these grander ideas, and then we wind up doing those. And then we're like, more batting, more padding, more smooth, more awesome. So it went from this thin satin stuff, the shiny satin stuff, and then it goes to like upholstery fabric with interfacing and like hand quilting. And then you're kind of like hoping they don't cut you out of your armor because you passed out.
Of course, now people are using, you know, entire leather hides in their cosplay. You know, we've gone from costume satin to using actual genuine organic parts.
Yeah, I know. I remember seeing, it was like a few weeks ago, maybe, some dude who made like an entire Space Marine armor out of leather.
Yeah, it was BlizzCon.
For BlizzCon. And then Prince Armory, whose stuff makes me go, oh, I mean, it's staggering. I'm like, I made a belt.
It was a good belt.
I'm thinking I'm the shit because I made a belt, you know.
Oh, so no, it's cool.
No, I mean, it's all good. I mean, I just really, in the end, I'm like, I feel like Altair snick it with the hidden blade. Yeah. I don't care if someone's like, hey, are you a pirate? Fine.
So speaking of AC, it is fairly well known that you have a great love for AC. What prompted you to start turning the video game into real life things?
I was at anime, you know, I love just like cool things, and I saw the Hidden Blade, and I was at Anime Central, like, I think 2008, 2009. And I was hearing, I mean, you know, I had a few prints of Assassin's Creed, and I, you know, when an AC cosplayer walked by, I'm like, oh, it's so cool. So I was like, throwing prints at him. I'm like, here. And one of them told me about this guy who had this, like, perfect Assassin's Creed costume. So I had, like, this hope that I'd bump into this guy as inspiration, and I didn't. So I kind of went home, and then I was like, man, I want to do something that's that awesome. And I had all these ideas of, woo, this awesome, my, you know. And then, also, I wanted a Hidden Blade, and an excuse to wear it. I went to a Tandy Leather factory because I think that I always kind of feel like each of these costumes is an opportunity to experiment and learn like new techniques and things. So if something's leather, I'll try to make it in leather. If something had chainmail, you know, I'll learn how to make chainmail. I went to Tandy with an action figure, like, boop, boop, boop. How do I make this? And I was kind of scared. I thought it was just kind of like, you know, a bunch of little mountain guys making gun holsters. But man, there's a bunch of nerds in there making pirate outfits and reenactment and steampunk and SEA. And they're like, oh, okay, Altair. I know that dude. It, yeah, son has it. So I picked the dude's brain for 3 hours and did leather working, a bunch of leather working, and then I heard about another dude in an awesome costume. I'm like, oh, this is going to be awesome. It's going to be like an Altair army. I still kept not running into them. And then, like, a few months later, someone said, hey, did you check out the cosplay.com thread? And I'm like, what? There's a thread for this? This is so cool! And you know, I joined it, and we're all just going, each other, and it just kind of blossomed from there, and we all just wound up super rabid, and, you know, the rest is history. So, it was pretty cool. I really, you know, I wouldn't change it for the world. I mean, if I did it again, I'd totally do it again, if I had to. An adventure, and the best part was meeting so many other people who are interested in like techniques and trading ideas, and then it all comes together in funny, just this really cool outfit. And, you know, that was, it's been like awesome. I think we're MTAC 1 year. We had our car was totaled and we had a new van. And I christened it by finding as many Assassin's Creed cosplayers and packing them into the trunk like frat boys in a phone booth. We got 9 in there, and the Templars stayed 9? Out of the car. They're like, 9. A friend has it on, I think she posted it on DeviantArt somewhere, but they're like, okay, we'll join you. Oh. So
there had to have been like pictures or video of this just for posterity's sake.
I have a couple pictures somewhere, but yeah, if you want me to send them to you later, I could do that. I don't know. I
was just for this episode.
It's like, why the heck not? I mean, because my costume, I'm like, dude, I'm in an outfit. I can't 100% take myself seriously. I dress like what everybody thinks I'm a pirate or the guy with the floofy collar. Yeah.
You can't take cosplay too seriously.
No, I can't. I mean, I take the work seriously because it's a learning thing and commissions, but when I'm in the costume, people are like, try to be, hardcore. I take it. And I'm like, okay.
So there's quite a bit of your work that is now available in your shop, which can be found at fevstudios.com. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of diverse things here. You can get prints. You can actually get physical copies, castings of these things. So what's it like running a business and doing these sort of things?
It's interesting times, actually. when I first started doing, I had not really even thought of making this a business other than making a prop and then having some friends like badger me to make stuff for them. I had made a belt from Assassin's Creed. I think there's one over here. Nope, I'm not getting up. I just made it for my costume. I thought nothing of it. And since I had some, I sculpted it and I had some extra resin, and I told a couple other AC cosplayers, I'm like, I finished my belt, see? I'm going to probably glue another one on the hood of my car or something. And they're like, hey, why don't you give it to me instead? I'll sell it to you. I can sell it to you. And then, explosion. So, I could not even keep up. I could not even remotely have kept up. I didn't have an online store where people could do that. So it was like every person who requested, they sent me an email and I sent them info. And then like four or five times back and forth before, you know, something it completed. So eventually I got off my duff and figured out an online shop. And now it's people start asking about other parts. So, I mean, I don't do stuff just to sell. I make stuff for my costumes, and then, you know, someone else needs one because that belt is a pain. So, I just said, hey, it's pretty much helped out a cosplayer. You know, I've been just kind of grew from there. And now I'm doing some commissions for various people. Kathy from God Save the Queen she's awesome. I mean, she sends me like all sorts of crazy leather work projects. Lord of the Rings, she's like, here, cast like 1,800 little plates from Lord of the Rings. We need them.
I'm like, there ended up being extra of those afterwards.
Yes,
right?
There was. Apparently, she said, we overestimated a little. So I think they had like 4 or 5 extra kits available. And So that was an adventure. I mean, I never had to cast that many things for a project. So I sculpted one and then I cast 10 of those. And then I molded that. And then it was like 4 days straight of being in the shop, like marathoning. Jeez, I think it was Parks and Recreation or something when I was like marathoning this like days. It was crazy. So it was pretty insane.
As a Lord of the Rings fan, if you guys just want to see some amazing work, go on Feb's website and look at the Legolas quiver. That is an amazing piece of work.
Thank you.
I mean, there are other amazing works, but that one in particular, just the harness had to be almost impossible to figure out.
Okay. Oh, I got to tell you about the harness. So this was maybe about 3 days before Dragon Con. I was in a panic with everything, of course. You know how everything is like that. Everybody, we're like, we're going to be on time. We're going to get this down. Everybody's still in the shop finishing things. And like my husband took the day off. I mean, he wasn't feeling good anyway. So, you know, and then he helped me in the shop. And we spent 2 days straight ticked off trying to figure out the loops and twists and stuff from that quiver. And it was insane. Like, I think it was about 4 o'clock in the morning when he said, yeah, I got it. I'm going to sleep. And I'm like, this is, oh my gosh, it actually works. Because in the film, there was one loop that they should have used. And they didn't. So it threw everything off. And they kind of just cheated it most of the time anyway. The whole thing looks like a whole thing. They just kind of hitch onto his back.
They did.
And yeah, so I was like, this is awesome. So I started unstrapping it. And I'm like, oh no. So I stopped, put it back together enough. Because, you know, I have to now replicate all of this stuff in leather. We did it all in foam for the mock-ups. That makes, you know, it's cheaper. So we got all that stuff together. And so I grabbed a video camera and then videotaped myself on a set disassembling this thing, because it took like 3 hours for me to figure out how to put it back together the first time took it apart. So I actually need to go now this year. I'm starting to do, I'm going to be doing more videos and stuff. And that's one of them, because I know there's some Legolas people out there who are just having a sad day with those strappings. And I don't want them to ever have to deal with that themselves. Here, have a video.
I think the people on Alley Cat Scratch, which is the big LOTR costume repository, would love to get their hands on that video.
Yes, that they are. They, oh man, they are amazing. They're where I got maybe 95% of my references. So thank you so much, Alley. Thank you for all of your hard work and dedication. That. He saved me. So, yeah.
So a little bit more off the wall kind of questions, because we like to end things on a little bit more fun note. Mm-hmm. So given all of your experience, what 3 tools should all cosplayers have if they do, you know, prop making kind of work?
A Dremel. Yes. Okay. That's definitely one. 3, the other two.
They can be generic categories of things. They don't have to be like specific things.
Oh, belt sander. That will make your life everything easier. Band-aids. Lots of band-aids.
That's 3.
Band-aids.
But do they have to be Mickey Mouse band-aids?
No, you could use Transformers or How to Train Your Dragon. And what there's, Star Wars, Skylanders, anything like that. And then larger band-aids, because sometimes something must occasionally get you. So, yeah, you want to be careful.
All right. And the other question that I wanted to ask was if you have a favorite technique that you've learned.
Silver powder. Spray paint and silver powder. So, okay, my bear hat. The bear. So, I had to do Nordic armor and trying to get like that weathered and worn look by painting it and then going back and trying to add weathering. You know, it kind of, you know, most of the time our minds don't work super random unless we're just like literally throwing crap at it. And we want it to be a little more controlled. So one thing I figured out eventually was using silver powder and a can of spray paint. So I'll spray this thing. It's a bear hat. Yeah. I'll spray it lightly. You know, I'll coat the thing with the whatever base, and then I'll spray it lightly with either black spray paint or a hammered metal paint. And then I'll let it stay, kind of get a little tacky. And then I'll use metal powders. I think there might be one over here. No, metallic powders. And take some and just tap it on my finger and go like that. And it's like almost, it very quickly just lays down all of the weathering and wear and everything. You just got to make sure that it's not too wet so your fingers don't stick. But if something, if you get a sticky spot or something, you just put more paint on there and rub it. So you're just kind of rubbing it down and just, you know. And like, I think I did this hat in maybe about 15 minutes altogether, all like the whole painting process. So it's really quick. It gives a nice, worn, weathered finish. And if you use satin paint, satin spray paint, it'll give more of this burnt, like, duller. If it's gloss, you'll actually get a little bit of a chrome finish to it, too. So it's awesome. I love it. It saved my life. I was able to wear my armor during the con versus not. And I'll actually be doing a video for that, too. I have the video footage of it, and I just need to go and cut it together. So that will be available very
really
soon,
cool.
too. So, I mean, I did that with this, the sacks here, too. I mean, that was...
Same technique?
Same technique. And you could also do it with other color powders and stuff like that, too. And you could use other base colors. So you could get some, like, crazy fairy colors and stuff, too. And that took maybe about 30 minutes. Paint it. So
that's really quick.
Yeah. So that's been like probably one of my saving. It's been my one of my saviors. So I'll be doing a video. So you know, you guys don't have to spend like 2 days painting like one little thing. Whatever. So
no worries. I wanted to go ahead and end the core part of the interview with asking if you have any advice for people who are just starting out.
There are gajillions of tutorials and resources out there now that you could go. How do you paint metal armor? How do you paint realistic metal armor? And you'll probably run across stuff from Will Morgan and Vulpen Props and Bill Doran and some dumb Twitch from me and tons of other people. And then on top, besides type, you know, just doing a search for paint, how do I make a Assassin's Creed belt buckle? You go, how do I sculpt the buckle? Or something. You could also look on like sci-fi and reenactment and SCA, the Society for Creative
Anachronism.
And just not just in like looking specifically for the costume you're doing, your specific costume, but just in general. I mean, I found techniques from making like Jack Sparrow gear for Aveline, who's like right here, for like the belts and stuff, weathering the belts. I'll use like my friend Brent, Force Be With Ya, cosplay, who actually I found out was that legendary Ace and Assassin's Creed cosplayer. So that was awesome meeting him. He did Boba Fett costuming. He did Mandalorian costuming, and a lot of that involves extensive weathering, so we applied that to his Altair costume, and that just like killed it. I mean, I'm still learning like with to really make that pop and everything too. So there's so many resources out there, and don't limit yourself just to that one particular, you know, how do I make a Naruto headband. I mean, you could, how do I metal, how do I like engrave metal. I mean, so there's tons of resources out there. It didn't used to be like that. And there's people who have been doing this stuff since like the 60s and 70s. And there's professional seamstresses. You could go into a like a bootmaker's shop and man, those guys are like, someone asked me a question. Yes. So, yeah, it's like unlimited nowadays, especially now. It was kind of like underground before, but not anymore. Yeah.
So being nerdy is now normal.
Yes. Yes. So once CBS goes from, look at the smelly nerds during their 5-minute segment for Dragon Con to, fans were out today for Dragon Con and having morning segments, and it's totally different from even 4 or 5 years ago, you know. So you're seeing people who might go to sports games. Oh, the Salvation Army, who had a convention 1 year for Dragon Con, during the same year, you're finding like people in these, most of them wearing like stark white outfits. So you start seeing little stark, these white dots in Star Trek panels and Doctor Who panels, and just sprinkled in there along with all this dark, trying to be all hardcore dark colors. So it's gotten really big and it's awesome. So yeah.
Agreed. Well, thank you so much, Leif, for the interview. I hope you guys enjoyed that as much as I did. I was trying really hard not to be giddy on camera.
It's okay if you were. We weren't going to stop you.
I know. I did want to mention on the side, and this came up recently, but it looks like Fev has actually had catastrophic hard drive failure, and a lot of her project files were on that hard drive. And if you're a prop maker, you know how important things like blueprints, diagrams, and basically notebooks of instructions are, especially when you're having to recreate those things. And so she has put up a GoFundMe page, and we can, you know, link that in the show notes. Mm-hmm. But we just wanted to put it out there. We're not necessarily saying you should, you know, everybody should give money to it. We're simply saying the opportunity is here, so that if you wish to help her out, please go take a look at her GoFundMe page. If you wish to donate, please do. Mm-hmm. If you don't, that is okay. But it looks like she is offering a few things like plans, sketches, patterns, and other things as incentives for people to help out, because she's trying to basically get her data off of these damaged hard drives so that she can go back to projecting and prop making. So as a fellow prop maker, I feel for her, because having all of your electronic copies of things like blueprints die, then you basically have to go through and recreate everything all over again. And that can be a pain in the butt.
Tech issues blow.
Yes. Tech issues seriously can blow.
There's just no way around it. They blow.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. we're both fully aware based off of our... This is one of the reasons why we had to upgrade our camera so soon, was because we were just having issues with using the DV tape so many times. After a couple of uses, they're moot. You can't use them anymore.
Yeah, tapes would die.
It sucks.
Which, you know, that happens as technology gets older, which is really relative in today's terms, because now 2 years old is old.
Old. I mean, heck, my computer is maybe a year and 3 months old, and it's old. I'm like, dude, no, it's still in great condition. Don't tell me it's old. Don't lie to me.
But anyways, that is all we have for you guys in this episode 108 of CosPod, the podcast for all things cosplay. You can reach us on all of our social media, which you can see here. Make noise, Val.
Here.
Thank you.
Welcome. There you go.
Of course, if you guys were at PAX South and want to share your pictures, please do, as we would love to share those with our audience. Or if you are at other conventions, because of course PAX South is not the only convention that is going on, you know, over the next couple of weeks. So if you guys have convention reports, we would also love to share those. You guys can always email us, podcast@cospod.org, if you would like to ask us about submitting, you know, photos or convention reports, or if you just want to chat, because we're always helpful. We're always willing to offer advice should you wish to ask. You can always ask us questions. If you have comments on the show, we're always happy to get those as well, preferably constructive criticism. I'd like to give a shout out to all of our new international listeners. We are gaining international listeners by the day. And that is so awesome to see, seriously. It's really flattering.
she's having a moment.
I am having I've been having a moment for the last 100 episodes. But anyways, we will see you guys next time in episode 109. Happy cosplaying, everybody.
Bye, everybody.